I don't see any more people joining. We already have attendees. I guess we can start. So good morning, everyone, once again. My name is Konstantinos Kotsalos. I'm part of the R&D team of European Dynamics. From my side, I would like to welcome everyone to the first Interface Open Call webinar. I would also like to inform you and remind you that there is a second webinar in the upcoming week on the 30th of March, which is related to the other three business use cases that they are open for innovators. So today's agenda is shared. I guess you can see my screen. So we'll start with an introduction for myself, in order to provide you an introduction to the Interface project, its strategic objectives, and the implemented platform of which is called IEGSA. And then we'll have a presentation from Maria Papadimitriou from Syntec, which will give you all the details about the open calls and how you can apply to them. And then we will have three slots related to the to three out of the six business use cases, two from ENTSO-E, which will be presented by Ali Fahri, and the other business use case from UPRC, which will be presented by Ioannis Panagakidis. So before starting, also I would like to mention that any questions can take place in the Q&A of this framework, of the Zoom framework. So I will share my presentation now. I see my screen. So in this presentation, I will provide you a short overview of the Interface project and its objectives, the vision of Interface, as well as the implemented interoperable platform of IEGSA and its functionalities in brief, as well as the demo areas. So some words about Interface. Interface is funded under the umbrella of TSO, DSU, DSO consumer large-scale demonstration of innovative grid services through demand response, storage, and small-scale renewable energy generation. The title of Interface stands for TSO, DSO consumer interface architecture to provide innovative grid services for an efficient power system. The duration of the project is 4 years, and it has started in January 2019. Within the consortium of Interface, there is a very large consortium of 42 partners. Amongst them, we have seven TSOs, eight DSOs, two energy suppliers, two energy service companies and aggregators, one regulator, one market operator, nine service technology providers, as well as nine research partners and one international organization. So the Interface vision is to provide a common architecture that is capable to connect multiple actors and markets in a transparent and non-discriminatory manner. This is foreseen to take place by the efficient coordination of the system operators, the transmission system operators and distribution system operators, by their common procurement of grid services, of course, by providing also incentives to the connected consumers via the the utilization of their flexibility. This is foreseen to take place via advanced digital technologies with a connection of multiple actors that they will be sharing in a transparent manner their data through the foreseen platform of the interface. Among interface, it is foreseen to provide, to bring consumer in the center by participating in the wholesale and balancing markets through a novel design of markets in order to have an efficient procurement of grid services and with the participation of flexibilities. This is also foreseen to integrate small scale and large scale assets at the same time in order to increase the market liquidity for the procurement of flexibility, scaling up multiple grid services. Continuing the IEGSA concept, which is essentially the platform that is envisioned to be implemented in interface, IEGSA stands as an interoperable pan-European grid services architecture to act as the interface between the power system, utilities, so essentially the TSO and TSOs, and the consumers in order to allow the seamless and coordinated operation of all these stakeholders to use and procure common services. So essentially is a common architecture that stands as an ecosystem for multiple actors to ensure their data and information exchange amongst them in order to optimize the operation by introducing standardized services within their procurement via innovative market design. The incorporation of multiple stakeholders is foreseen to take place in all energy value chain by offering equal chances to all players to participate in grid services. The IEGSA architecture is designed in a modular and scalable way, and essentially it is comprised of four main functional models: the flexibility register, which is essentially the core component, as we will explain also in the next slides; the TSO-TSO coordination platform; the single interface to market; and the settlement unit. All these modules can operate independently, and they can be also interconnected with customized APIs for multiple purposes, such as the connection with multiple different market designs, with different settlement algorithms, as well as algorithms that are related to the qualification of grid and incoming bids. So the interface architecture, here it is essentially illustrated in the ESCAM framework. So we can see that multiple actors, such as flexibility service providers, consumers, prosumers, the utilities, and the market operators are connected through the IEGSA platform in order to perform multiple services that can ensure the engagement of flexibility. Such processes are related to the grid qualification, the product qualification, the procurement of frequency and non-frequency services, the activation, which can take place also via the IEGSA platform, and the settlement processes in order to settle the activated volumes of bids. In the functional layer, essentially, we can see the four main modules of the IEGSA: the flexibility register function, in which basically flexibility service providers can connect to manage their portfolio, register their assets, and create research groups in order to optimize, to participate, subscribe in multiple products, that they can participate in multiple product services. The TSO coordination platform, which is a module that ensures the coordinated operation of TSOs and DSOs for the procurement of grid services. The single to market interface function, which essentially connects the EGSA platform with multiple market design and multiple marketplaces, and the settlement unit function for settlement for the settlement processes. In the information layer, it is worthy mention that there is the interface design data governance tool that leverages essentially all the information from the multiple actors, which is also compliant with the common information model, which is standardized by the international standards. It is also worthy mentioning in the communication layer that the EGSA is foreseen to accommodate the ECOSP, which is designed by ENTSO-E, to ensure secure operation via multiple client servers. Some more information about the EGSA functionalities. Market operators can register their multiple product definitions. The flexibility service providers can register multiple their assets essentially in order to create resource groups which can subsequently participate in multiple product services accordingly. The resource qualification, which ensures that the connection of the registered resource groups doesn't provoke any technical challenges into the grid, any technical problems into the grid. The product qualification to ensure that the product subscriptions are eligible with the product definitions. And then we have the trading processes, which are related to accommodate the incoming bids, the bid qualification, and of course, activation processes, and then the settlement processes for the settling of the activated volume. Now some information about the demo areas of interface. The interface demos are classified into three main pillars in order as a target to mitigate the congestions and activate local flexibility resources for the system balancing services through the EGSA platform, which are operated by TSOs and DSOs in a coordinated manner. The second pillar, which is to promote the integration of the distributed energy sources into electricity markets and to demonstrate mechanisms that lead to the establishment of a seamless pan-European market. And the third pillar, which is related to the state-of-the-art digital technologies such as blockchain for peer-to-peer energy transactions that promote local markets and smart asset management. So very briefly, the first demo area is also comprised of three demos. The first one related to the TSO and consumer alliance via the proposition of a centralized energy management system for microgrids. The intelligent, the second one, which is related to the proposition of grid services management system for flexible low voltage, medium voltage networks in Bulgaria, which is foreseen to take place with intelligent distribution nodes. The third one, which is related to an exchange platform for distributed flexibilities in an end-to-end electricity networks, which takes place with a connection of Finland, Estonia, and Latvia. The second demo pillar, which is the peer-to-peer trading, has two demos, one related to the to microgrid local electricity markets by using the asset capabilities in Hungary and Slovenia. The second one, which is related to blockchain-based TSO-DSO flexibility with the proposition of a market platform with smart contracts and smart billings in Bulgaria and Romania. And the third demo pillar, which has two demos for the pan-European clearing markets. The first one related to the distributed energy sources into wholesale markets via retail to wholesale market approach for distributed energy resources integration, where there are demo sites, Romania, Bulgaria, and Greece. And the last one, which is entitled Spatial Aggregation of Local Flexibility, which is also related to incorporate the Eufemia-based market platform to engage local flexibility resources. This is also related to one of the business use cases that will be presented later on by our interface colleagues from UBRC. The other business proposals, as I said in the beginning, are related to the ENTSO-E business proposals. To the first one, to extend functionalities of IEGSA, as we'll see analytically, and the other one, to exploit that information that are accommodated in the transparency platform for the better understanding of the flexibility needs into several markets. Thank you very much for your attention. I guess we could continue with Maria's Papadimitriou presentation, which will be related about all the details of the open call. If there are questions about interface, don't hesitate to contact us, but we will have much time in the end of all the sessions to discuss also general information project as well. Maria, if you can share your screen.
Yes, good morning, my greetings to all. You should allow me to share it. I cannot. Okay, now I can. Thank you.
Yes, my announcer can see.
Okay. Is it clear?
Yes, it's fine.
So this is Maria Papadimitriou. I'm a project manager of Syntec Solutions. Syntec is responsible for the preparation and the implementation of Interface Open Call. This open call opens for submissions on March 30. Some information on the call. The origin of the funding is a European financial support in the framework of Phase 2020 program. The funding offered to third parties is for the implementation of interface objectives. The total budget per party cannot exceed 60,000 euros. And the financial support follows the EU funding scheme. That means that 70% funding will be provided for not-for-profit organizations and 100% for non-profit organizations. The financial scheme is 25% pre-financing for selected third parties, and further payments will be delivered after a successful implementation of milestones and deliverables. Who are eligible for funding are any legal entity possessing a PIC number. That means public or private bodies, research organizations, non-profit organizations, small and medium enterprises, international organization of EU interest established in an EU member state or in an associated country. If proposals are awarded the equal score, SMEs and startups will have a priority. Some further submission rules. English language is the only official language. All parts of the proposals shall be in English, otherwise it will be rejected. One submission per applicant will be accepted. If multiple ones identified, the first submitted in order of time will be the one that will be evaluated. There is a strict deadline. This is the 30th of June at 5 o'clock set time. The system will block automatically. Please do not wait for a last minute proposal submission. If a failure for the proposal to arrive in time occurs, whatever reason, including extenuated condition, the result will be that the proposal will be rejected. The proposal shall be submitted only through the portal. Otherwise, again, we cannot accept it by mail. And applicants shall be aware that they do not have any actual or potential conflict of interest with the interface open call process. The call initiative is to develop and extend different infrastructure and state-of-the-art technologies of interface architecture and data management services to be implemented and validated by the interface pilots. Particularly, participants are asked to address one of the six different use cases which are covering the major domains in which the interface project members operate. The proposed functionalities shall promote and enable flexibility of end users, and they shall increase flexibility awareness and flexibility needs along the grids, attracting more flexibility players in the marketplaces. As Costantino said, we have six business cases under which interested parties shall submit their proposal. These are the utilization of existing ENTSO-E transparency platform data and the development of an application that will serve as a data provider for IEGSA. This will be elaborated by Ali at the next session. The third business use case are aggregators and open energy communities intelligence services for congestion management. The fourth one is an advanced tech base to manage and operate a local energy community. And the fifth is flexibility service providers, including aggregators with demand response and distributed energy resources as grid service providers. The sixth business case that we'll see today is the development of an open access generic forecasting methodology for the determination congestion management requirements in power systems. What are the supporting materials for the applicants? This is the guide for applicants. First of all, it is a helpful guide that provides information for the submission of proposal and evaluation process in the framework of the interface project. The open call portal has all the material uploaded, and this is via this portal that applicants should register and submit their proposals, and by this portal, the evaluation will be implemented. An open call help desk is available for any queries that might arise, either technical or for the processes. And a frequently asked questions subpage is available and will be updated in 3 days. The open call documents that are available are the core announcement, the guide for applicants, the eligible countries. This is part of the regulation. And when interested parties would register, the proposal template and the declaration of honor will be also unlocked. Allow me to navigate you a little bit on the portal. OK, Okay, this is the open call portal. All the necessary materials are in the sub-page resources, the important docs, the important days, you can find them here. As I've said, the submission opens on the 30th of March and the deadline is on the 30th of June. By September the 10th, the results will be announced. There are 10 business days after results publication for any objections. By late October, the contract period will end, and then the beneficiaries will be able to start by December 2021 for the implementation of their proposals. This period cannot exceed 6 months duration. On the resource, you can also find the facts page. It will be updated currently. These are the categories. By clicking one of these, you can find the questions, and by clicking the plus symbol, you can find the answers to these. So the homepage has general information for the eligibility and where you can find helpful information. This is on the project sub-page, it's a direct link to the interface project. And next is the business use cases. Here you can find the 6 business cases, and by clicking in one of these, you can find the detailed information provided by the demos. Information are also included as annexes in the guide for applicants. On the open call sub-page, there is the application steps and the evaluation processes and criteria in charts for convenience. And news and events, you can find here any updates or any important information that you should be informed for. And for now, on the events page, there are the webinars, but it will be updated. So to log in, you can go either on the right here, and there is also the applicants area on the bottom bar. Whatever you decide, it's the same. By clicking one of these, you can go in this page, and you can register or log in. And then the material will unlock. I think this is it for the portal. So to continue, a few information for the evaluation. The evaluation follows the European Commission rules. Proposals will be evaluated under the criteria of impact, technical quality, and quality of the work plan. The sub-criteria are described in details in the guide for applicants, so you can see what are the questions that you should address. There are 4 phases for the evaluation. First of all is the eligibility check, is a pass or fail procedure. Then the eligible proposals will be assigned to 2 experts. This proposal for, will be assigned to 2 experts, and they will conduct an individual evaluation report. Afterwards, the 2 experts and a reporter will decide on the final score, and the consensus report will result in a final ranking that will be reviewed during a panel meeting by all experts. And experts will then discuss and decide on the final selection list, and they will draft an evaluation summary report. These are the deadlines for the evaluation period. And then by the 10th, the results will be announced on the portal, but also the evaluation summary report will be communicated to applicants by mail. As I said, there are 10 business days for objections. Objections should be delivered only by mail. And there are some guidelines on the guide for applicants on how to implement this process. So objections reviewed and the final results will be announced shortly after objections period. And then the contracting period follows. The contract will be signed between the Cascade funding partners and the beneficiaries of the open call. This contract includes payment modalities, financing payments, IPR handling, conflict resolution rules, the rights by the European Commission and other European bodies to carry out checks and audits, and any other information that beneficiaries and partners should settle. All selected third parties shall comply with the following obligations, that is avoidance of conflicts of interest, confidentiality, dissemination of the action and visibility of the EU funding, and liability for damages. Important is that if selected third parties fail to sign the contract or to deliver the documentation needed in time, applicants are listed in the reserve list will substitute the above ones in order of rank. When contracting period ends, the development can start. This will not be later than the 31st of December. A support meet team, for its business use cases will mentor the beneficiaries for the whole time. All required documentation and services that are required should be submitted before the defined deadline. And the overall duration of the implementation cannot exceed 6 months. Following this, the results will be analyzed and clustered to identify synergies. And there will be conducted an evaluation on the overall impact of the open call projects on interface and energy ecosystems. So this is my final slide. Thank you for your attention. I am happy to answer for any comments that might arise regarding the processes.
Thank you very much, Maria, for your presentation. I would like to remind to all the attendees that questions can be posed in the Q&A of Zoom. There is already one question.
Yes, I'm reading it now. It's 60,000 for the third party. Consortia are not, if I'm answering George's question, consortia are not accepted. So it's the third party and the challenge is pretty much the same. Okay, George.
No, I think that I have nothing to add. So indeed, the maximum, the 60,000 euros is for one applicant. And this is what I was going to mention, that we are not going to have a consortia in this application.
Okay. Maria, there is one more question. In any case, before responding to the question, I would like to remind that in the very end of the agenda, we have reserved much time to discuss all issues about the open funding processes and all questions related to the business proposals as well.
Okay, the confirmation mail should be received shortly, but I will check it.
Okay, then.
Can proceed, then I will type the answer.
So, and for the rest of the attendees that joined later, let me remind again the agenda. Now we'll start the session of the presentation of the business use cases by starting with the first business use case by ENTSO-E, which will be presented by Ali Fakhri. Then we'll have a short coffee break. Then Ali Fakhri will continue with the second business use case proposed by ENTSO-E. And then the third business use case will be presented by Ivan Pakilis from PSC. And then we will have a reserved slot to respond to any type of questions. So Ali, please share your screen and please.
Thank you, Konstantinos.
Thank you very much.
Let me share my screen. I cannot open my camera, it's not allowed, but let me share my screen. And please let me know when you see my presentation. Okay, I think you can hear me and see my presentation.
Yes, it's fine.
Okay. Thank you, Konstantinos, once again, and Maria, for the nice and informative informations. I think our participants are already excited to hear more about the business use cases. My name is Ali Fakhri. I'm an electrical engineer, specialized in power system engineering, and working at ENTSO-E to support transparency platform-related activities. Today, I will present you two business use cases related to the transparency platform and the transparency requirements for flexibility markets. And the first one will be about the utilization of the existing transparency platform data based on the needs for the flexibility markets. Here you can see the outline of my presentation. I will first start to give you information about why we focused on the transparency aspects of the flexibility markets. Secondly, I will briefly mention about the transparency platform and what's available on the platform in terms of data items. And then the business use case descriptions will follow that and providing details about what is expected and what is aimed with this business use cases. Then I will give information about the possible data download options from the transparency platform. Finally, I will mention about possible data sets to improve transparency in the flexibility markets to provide you some intuition. Then we can move on to the Q&A sessions to answer your questions. For the open call, as ENTSO-E, we turned our focus on to support the transparency requirements of the flexibility markets. Therefore, I'd like to mention first why we focused on that. The first thing is transparency is very essential for the market efficiency, liquidity, and competitiveness. And a transparent market for sure will attract more service providers and will trigger more investments. And this will result in a more efficient and well-functioning markets. In addition to that, it will also bring the chance to compare the provided and purchased services among players. And thanks to that, the players will better value the services they provide in the market. And moreover, security of supply and reliability will be increased by attracting more market players, because more players will mean higher available capacities in the market. It will provide investment signals where the grid needs more flexible capacity, and prices and activated capacities in regions will reveal the information for the system needs, and it will help to meet the supply demand in the long run. And another advantage is coming from the grid investment perspective. Having an efficient congestion management with a transparent flexibility market can result in deferring the need for high cost further grid enhancements. And last but not least, by providing the same level of information about among the market participants, the risk related to the market abuse will be mitigated. Let me move on to the overview of TP, starting from the legal base. Transparency platform is grounded on a new regulation, and it dates back to June 2013 and gives some responsibilities to ENTSO-E, to market players, and also to transmission system operators. Under the light of this regulation, ENTSO-E developed a set of documentation called Manual of Procedures, which declared the technical and operational criteria that the data providers and the transparency platform application will need to fulfill. And this set of documentation defines the core of the transparency platform. It contains very useful information for any users that are interested to transparency markets as well. And these documents you see on the right bottom becomes more technical when you go down. I will briefly mention about what kind of information each document consists of, and how these documents relate to each other, and how this can be used by the participants. Firstly, the detailed data descriptions documents provide information about each single data item available on the transparency platform. It specifies what these items corresponds to, what is the submitted data represents, and how it is calculated, if there is any calculation methodology for this data item before submitting to transparency platform, and when this data should be expected on transparency platform, I mean the publication deadlines. And you can also find information for who is the primary owner of the data. And this document also gives information about the possible data updates, whether it's the last update for the data, or is there any room for further updates so that you can expect some more updates in the long run for this data item or not. And moving to the business requirement specification, it's constituted based on the data descriptions documentation. It defines the required functionalities on the transparency platform, also provides information for how incoming data will be processed, what are the required configurations on the platform, how data will be displayed, and so on. And finally, the implementation guides, which define the standards of the data exchange in terms of the required attributes and parameters, and what parameters are required for data submissions, what will be returned when you download the data, and what each parameter really means and represents. Moving next, I will briefly mention about the available data on the transparency platform. In total, there are 134 data items on the platform that are grouped under seven different domains, as you can see on the slide. And I will name some of the most popular ones. Under load domain, for example, PP provide information about the actual loads per data, per country, per area, and per country. And you can also find load forecasts with different time frames in advance, like day ahead, month ahead, and up to year ahead forecast. And for generation domain, data for installed capacities of big power plants are available. You can also find actual generation of these generation plants, in addition to the amount of generation per reserve type on the transparency platform. And for transmission domain, TP provides information about the cross-border flows and the scheduled flows between the bidding zone, also offered and allocated capacities on the lines, together with some additional information also for forecasted capacities available. And the next one is the outages domain. It is one of the most popular domain among others. There you can find information about the planned outages on the transmission grid or offshore grid for wind generation. Also about the power plants and big consumption units. This domain not only includes the data for planned outages. If there is an outages that is not foreseen in advance, this information also becomes available on TP based on the requirements for data submissions. And the next domain is a balancing domain. I believe that information available on this domain will be very useful for this business case, because under this domain, you can find information about the bids submitted for balancing activities for different type of reserves. And this information includes the price and volume info as well. And on top of that, you can find information about procured capacities per reserve type and how much of them are activated and what's the average price for the activated reserves. And additionally, you can find the information for the imbalance state of the grid, whether there is a surplus or deficit, and what's the imbalance volume and the imbalance price, and so on. And under system operations domain, you can find frequency quality measurements and some agreements related with the synchronous areas and load frequency blocks. And finally, congestion management. You can find information for the activities to relieve the congested assets by TSOs, and also the associated costs to those activities on monthly basis are available. I believe this part will also be important and will be used as an input to create more added value for the flexibility markets. Let me move on to the details for the business use case description. With this business use case, the utilization of existing ENTSO-E transparency platform data, the participants are expected to identify, combine, and provide useful information for flexibility market players by using the existing data on transparency platform. And this is very important to provide a common ground for anybody who is interested to know more about the flexibility markets. And in addition to that, the useful information related to transmission grid level can be acquired to better serve for the flexibility markets and in the TSO-DSO coordination. Basically, this business case will encourage prototypes and applications to collect the existing transparency data and convert it to a more convenient, understandable, and useful form for flexibility markets with some additional added value on the values and like interpretation of the data available on the transparency platform, and it will also help for the flexibility for congestion management in the flexibility markets. And we also believe that these initiatives will be very helpful to understand the transparency requirements of the flexibility markets, and will help us to define the possible data sets, to define the required data sets to be published for the future in the transparency platform. And these defined data sets will be considered for sure also as recommendations for the regulators while defining the legislative background for the transparency requirements of the flexibility markets. And we as ENTSO-E will support the participants about the available data exchange channels of the transparency platform for the participants to reach to the existing data in a most efficient way. And currently we provide different means of data exchange options, and I will mention about them shortly in the next slide. And in the end, we expect from this business use case, from the participants, to propose new tools and applications that will be publicly accessible to be used for anyone interested in the flexibility markets. Let me briefly also mention about the possible data download options on the transparency platform. Currently, the TP provides 5 different ways of data download option, and users who are interested in the limit of data can directly download it from the graphical user interface with the export option in different formats like XML, CSV, and XLS. On the other end, SFTP is suitable for bulk data downloads for historical data. There you can find monthly group data per item, and these are available on the SFTP server, and they update once in every hour. Not close to real time, but once in every hour. And on the contrary, the RESTful API can serve for the ones who are interested in the most recent updates on the data that is closer to real time. But there are also some limitations apply for the requests in terms of the number of requests per minute a number of files to be downloaded per request, and the time window allowed for queries depending on the how heavy is the data item that is queried. And it is the most favorite option among the users of transparency platform. And we have more than 8 million API requests per day. And the next option is a data repository solution, which allows the data downloads up to 50 megabytes per request, and requests are processed in the background asynchronously and without imposing any load to the platform. And most of the time through web services, the requests are sent, and when data is available, users can download it from the transparency platform. And finally, the platform also allows users to subscribe for a data bit, in which the platform pushes the updates to the user's endpoint through a web service channel or ECP channel. And in my final slide, I would like to mention about some possible data sets for flexibility markets. Apart from the utilization of existing transparency platform data, researching on the requirements of the flexibility markets are also an important part of the suggested cases. As the ultimate goal of these business use cases is to develop the transparency aspects of the flexibility markets. And candidate sets you see in the table include the information about various suggested items. These includes data for distributed energy sources, demand responsive assets, distributed flexibilities in terms of nominal capacities, what is the type of generation, from which voltage level the sources are connected to the grid, and so on. And additionally, information about volumes and average prices for demand bids would be also an interesting one for further enhancing the transparency platform. And finally, I will touch to the ones related to the renewable energy part, the PV part. And as we walk down the street, day by day, we see more and more PV panels on the roofs. It's spread a lot, and it's becoming more and more common. And these can be considered as small scale installations, but these are, adds up to a really considerable amount of capacity that we need to get information for to better operate the grid and to better provide the grid services. It requires some visibility on these sources as well, about how much energy they produce, how much of the will be the generation forecast, and will there be any curtailment due to some overloads in the systems or not. And it's all will be very important information for the visibility of the flexibility markets. And we also would like the participants to further develop these sets by conducting research, by preparing some webinars, events to address the real needs of the transparency needs of the flexibility markets by getting into contact with the already existing market players, already existing businesses, and build the transparency requirements for flexibility markets together. And this concludes my presentation. Thank you for listening to me and your patience to keep your questions for a while. Now I think we can move to the Q&A sessions, and I will be happy to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Ali. So once again, I would like to remind you that you can post questions to everyone through the Q&A of Zoom. If there are questions related to this business use case, please feel free to ask. For general questions related to the open call, there will be also a reserve slot in the very end of the agenda.
And meanwhile, maybe I can just comment on the some incoming improvements for the transparency platform to enrich the data availability further. For example, at the pan-European level replacement reserve market has started operation, the Terre, called Terre, and transparency platform also get information from Terre about the replacement reserve markets, and it will be also followed by the Marie and Picasso projects, where the same concept will be applicable to the other type of reserves, MFRR and AFRR type of reserves. And this is becoming central, and the transparency platform will accommodate more and more data regarding the balancing domain. And this for sure will also will be considered as a guidance for the flexibility markets as well. And it will definitely help in terms of the prices and the activated reserves capacities, and it will really give a great picture of what is going on the balancing in markets.
Very nice. It's actually a very interesting business proposal. There is much data on the transparency platform that you can make much advantage of.
Yes, because there are more than 27,000 active registered users on the transparency platform, and we have many users with different profiles, like exchanges, trade offices, even media is also interested in the figures on the transparency platform. And a lot of companies are creating business on top of the available data on the transparency platform, because it provides the raw data, but you have the full flexibility to interpret this data and add some additional values to the services and to the subjects that you are interested in. So it can really provide a good source of information, and it's like it as a central source of information. And once you when you connect to the transparency platform, you can basically get data related to the grids, bids, and generation laws, everything about the electricity grids, and it really gives you a good overview in terms of understanding the situations, understanding the grids, understanding the operations, and it gives you a full picture.
Very nice. So there are no questions so far. We can have a short break, as it was also planned. So let's take a short break. Please be back at 10:45. So we have approximately 7 minutes of break. And we will continue with the second business use case by ENTSO-E and another business use case by UPRC related to the development of an open access generic forecasting methodology for the determination of condition management requirements in power systems. So, see you in a couple of minutes.
Constantinos, you are muted.
Thanks, Ali. Okay, I hope you enjoyed the short coffee break. I hope that you are all back also. In any case, the second business use case, it's again by ENTSO-E, entitled the development of an application that will serve as a data provider for the IEGSA platform of interface project. So, Ali, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Constantinos. Now I'm sharing my screen. And I think this time my camera is also open and you can see me as well.
Yes, we can see your screen as well.
Now, let me know when you see my presentation as well.
Yeah, now it's okay.
Okay, hello once again, everyone. For the newcomers, if any, my name is Ali Fahri and I'm working at ENTSO-E as a data publication lead and supporting the transparency platform for the support for data providers and users. And in today's second business use case, I would like to give you some more details for our case development of an application that will serve as a data provider for IEGSA. Here you can see the outline of my presentation. I will briefly mention about what actually being a data provider means and who are the data providers for the existing transparency platform. Then I will move on to the business use case description and we'll give you information about what is the aim of this business use case and what will be the benefits to the successful candidates. And on top of that, I will mention about the common information model, which constitutes the information layer for market data exchange and also ECO-SP for communication layer for data submissions. Finally, I will again quickly mention about the passable data sets to improve the transparency in flexibility markets for the newcomers, if there is any. Then starting with the data providers, today I used this term quite a lot. Therefore, it would be good to provide some additional details about it. And in accordance with the transparency regulation, the primary owners of the data should normally submit their data to their TSOs And then TSOs process the received data and deliver to the ENTSO-E. It says also possible that TSOs may delegate this activity to the third parties. And as expected, this will require some prior assessment, both from the technical and operational point of view. And successful operation of data providers are really, really important for the data availability on the transparency platform. Because each data item, depending on its nature and specifications, has some deadlines to be met in terms of submission. And these deadlines are most of the time monitored by the national regulatory authorities. And time to time, there might be some consequences for the TSOs and indirectly the data providers financially. And that's why the data provider role comes with very high responsibilities. And when we look at the existing platform, in addition to TSOs, we have other data providers with different profiles. For example, the exchange offices like EEX, Nord Pool, Hungarian Power Exchange, also provides information to a transparency platform. In additionally, coordination offices for auctions like JAO is also taking this responsibility. And the balancing platform that I mentioned during Q&A session, the Terra, where replacement reserve is exchanged, is also acting as a data provider to the transparency platform, and more balancing platforms, Mari and Picasso, is expected to come, and work is on progress to accommodate data from these platforms as well. And finally, the third party IT companies that are delegated by the TSOs are also welcome to submit data. Currently, we have around 60 data providers actively submitting data to transparency platform in total. So stepping into this environment will definitely increase the knowledge for startups to know more about the industry standards, and will open further business opportunities for them in this industry. Now, let me move on to the business case description. As I mentioned a couple of seconds ago, transparency platform is fed from the limited number of data providers as central sources. And it is not feasible for the TP operations to support the data exchange from too many different sources. It is not related to any technical constraints or any technical capacities. The platform can handle thousands of different data sources without any problem, but it's not feasible to support all sources individually from the operational point of view, because before submitting data to the platform, a lot of configuration and coordination effort is needed. Therefore, in order to increase operational efficiency, similar to the transmission domain data, we will expect flexibility market data to be submitted by a limited number of data providers. And being in line with that, in order to provide flexibility data to transparency platform in the future, it's quite likely that the IEGSA, an application developed on IEGSA, will act as a single or one of the few data providers for flexibility markets. To achieve this goal, we suggest a development of new tools and services under this business use case to add additional services and capabilities to IEGSA in terms of data exchange with the transparency platform. And relying on that, we expect participants to develop and build prototypes that can act as an interface for flexibility markets and build the bridge between IEGSA and the transparency platform. And since we don't have the regulation guidelines for flexibility markets yet, they are not quite clear for the time being, these proposed tools and platforms should be flexible enough to be able to aggregate and transform data into a format that will be required by the future regulatory framework to be able to meet the different requirements. And participants should also pay attention that all proposed solutions should be compatible with the common information model. The already existing profiles to exchange data for flexibility data can be sufficient, but in case of a need for development of new profiles to define the rules for data exchange, the profiles will be further enhanced, and then there are also some ongoing developments specific to flexibility markets as well. And in addition to the data exchange standards, data submissions need to be also compatible with one or more of the already available data channels used by the transparency platform. And finally, similar to the first business case, participants are encouraged to address the transparency need of the flexibility markets by digging into the needs of the already operating platforms to provide recommendations for regularity developments. And evaluation of this design structures will be made by our experts, as Maria explained in the beginning of this webinar. And moving to the next slide, I will give information about the CIM standards, which will play a key role to define the rules for data exchange. And these standards are built on the ISE standards provided in this slide. And in order to meet the changing requirements of data exchange with an increasing frequency, these standards are necessary and continuously evolving. As we are having more and more different types of players in the grid, in the energy markets, such as renewable battery systems, smart grids, electrical vehicles, the frequency of interaction and the number of players to interact with each other increases very sharply. And these developments also challenges the grid operators from the operational point of view. Therefore, it is very crucial to have an effective communication in the increasing between the increasing number of stakeholders. So if you can imagine an environment where we lack of such standards, it would be too complicated with too many reworks and would result in putting a lot of unnecessary effort and spending a lot of resources more than necessary. And in CIM, different business processes also requires some different profiles. For example, you will need a different document for exchanging the grid related data and another one to exchange the market related data, like such as generation schedules and trades, balancing resource management, and etc. And the same holds for flexibility markets as well, and the dedicated profiles to exchange the flexibility information are in progress and will be further developed when there is any any pops up. And following the profiles, the UML based the implementation guides are prepared for setting the rules of the information exchange. And for each process of data exchange, you can find the use case diagram to show which roles has which responsibilities, class diagrams showing about the relation between the entities and objects in the data structure, and also sequence diagrams to give information about the flow of the data exchange among the players. And this will all are very useful guidelines for a successful operation of data exchange among players. Moving to the submission channels for transparency platform, participants are expected to be compatible with one or more data submission channels that are supported by transparency platform. Currently, the platform supports for different channels, and since the EquoSP will be the one that's also widely utilized in the IEGSA architecture, it's strongly recommended for the participants to use that option as their primary option. And it will also make some future integrations easier when the regulatory requirements become more clear about how to accommodate the flexibility data on the transparency platform. I would like to also open an additional parenthesis here for the EquoSP, because it will be the backbone of the communication layer. It stays for the ENTSO-E communication and connectivity service platform, and it is widely used for data exchange for any type. It has two components, the ECP and the EDX, and the ECP is the commonly used one for transparency platform submissions. And I would like to give some overview starting with ACP. And ACP has four key functionalities. First one is related with the security. Yeah, it's a very secure communication tool because any kind of data in today's world needs a secure data transfer at some level to make sure that there is no leakage and intervention is in place on the data transfer. And this one is one of the key functionalities for the ECP provides. And from the very beginning of the development of this tool, it went through various test to challenge the security and always improved itself. So it's a very secure system to exchange critical grid-related data. And another key functionality is being compliant with the standards. ECP is built upon the standardization requirements coming from the market data exchange standards based on CIM. And it is a required standard by all the TSOs and many stakeholders in this environment accept and use it as a standard in the data exchange activities. And it is transparent as well, because each data exchange step includes an acknowledgement. So it makes every step traceable when any details is needed. And it's also very useful to evaluate how well is the system is performing. And finally, it's the reliability. It's a reliable application because no messages get lost within this ECP network. And it uses asynchronous communication technology, which is not exactly the real-time communication, but it is really close to real-time and just a divergence with a couple of seconds. And if you don't need a real-time data transfer, it's one of the best options available. And on top of ECP, based on some additional requirements, EDX component also have been developed and brought additional functionalities to the EchoSP. And the first one is about the capability of allowing a larger file size transfer. ECP on one hand provide message transfers size up to 50 megabytes. And in some cases, this is not sufficient. Therefore, EDX component comes into picture if such need arises, and the messages are first disassembled in the sending end, and then reassembled on the receiving end, and the size is no longer a problem. And the second important feature is the publishing subscribe functionality. Whenever a message is provided by a data provider, are distributed to the subscribers to exchange that message within the network. And finally, to enable a possibility to work with different standards, an integration channel layer is also built to allow transfer with possible new protocols that can come in the future. And ECP is kind of a component that become a standard between TSOs, and when there's a need for the functionalities provided also by EDX, they can be both used together. And for the startups participating, this code is business use cases. It will be also beneficial for them to develop and improve their know-how on such an application that is widely used in this energy industry. And finally, I would like to mention about some possible data sets quickly once again for the newcomers, if there is any. I already talked about them in the previous session, so don't want to take too much of your time. We would like to deeply analyze the market needs for the transparency platform and provide more possible data sets to address the needs of the market participants effectively. And you can here find a set of data items proposed, and these are just a proposal, nothing quite concrete yet from the regulatory perspective. So there is still too much room to improve this data sets to detect what's really matter for the players in the flexibility markets, so that this kind of information can be made available on the transparency platform to further enable the improvement of the flexibility markets. Thank you very much for your time and patience. Then this was my last slide. I think we can move on to the Q&A session if there will be any questions regarding this business use case, and also for the general questions for the open call as well.
Thank you, Arlene. Please let us know if there are any questions. You can pause them in the Q&A. Okay, no questions so far, so probably we can continue, and in any case, if the questions arose, we can discuss them in the last slot of the Q&A with today's agenda. Thank you, Ali, once again.
Thank you.
I would like to give the floor to Ioannis Panagakidis to present the last business case proposal for today.
Hello, can you see my screen?
Yes, Ioannis.
Thank you, Konstantinos. Good morning. My name is Ioannis Panapakidis, and I'm a researcher in University of Piraeus in Greece. I'm going to give you an overview of the business use case number 6, development of open access generic forecasting methodology for the determination of congestion management requirements in power systems. This is the outline of the presentation. It is composed by two parts. First of all, a presentation will be given regarding the optimization models of power markets and the demand and the renewable energy resources forecasting models that are currently under development. And next, we're going to move in the business use case number 6. Some details will be given, namely information about potential applicants, business case story, objectives, workflow, and demo area. This figure presents the interconnection of the three modules. We have a set of forecasting models. We have the day-ahead market model, DAM model, the balancing energy market model, BEM, and regarding the general operation, there are some initial forecasts of RES generation and demand from the respective models, and the market participants' adopted strategy are inputs of the DAM model. This is the initial input data. After the DAM model successful execution, the model determines the initial energy market schedule. Also, the cross-border electricity flows and the resulting electricity price in each bidding area. As test cases, we are currently examining the Hellenic power system, Bulgarian and Romanian. Based on the updated data of the forecasting models and the congestion management methodology, this is actually our proposal, the newly submitted bids of the market participants for the balancing market, and also the thermal units techno-economical data. We have the execution of the BEM model, which determines the optimal balancing energy and reserve scheduling. Also, the balancing market products includes some examples, upward and downward balancing energy, several types of reserve capacities such as FCR, EFRR, MFRR, and upward and downward congestion management capacity. So for the quantification of the congestion management requirements, the workflow will include different scenarios. We're going to present some later of installed capacities of generation units and RES penetration shares in order to solve an extended power flow analysis in some benchmark systems which are closed to the examined ones, namely Greek, Bulgarian, Romanian. Also, the outputs will refer to the determination of some identification indexes of congestion management resources. These slides present the structure of the optimization model. The model, the market optimization model, are formulated and solved as mixed integer linear problems that are solved under a highly efficient commercial solution. The DAM model, some further information, the prototype combines an ephemia-based economic dispatch for clearing of the day-ahead market with a detailed and unit commitment model for the procurement of some services, namely half-hourly products and for upward and downward balancing energy and half-hourly products for different reserve capacities. Some information again for the BEM model, more details. The BEM model builds upon the DAM model, resulting in an energy schedule with inclusion of some products. This is done for each bidding area. And another target is to produce a technically feasible schedule employing a higher temporal resolution and representing more accurate the units, the technical characteristics of the units. Also, please note we have three market designs, namely 1, 2, and 3. The first one involves node TSO-DSO coordination. The second one, we have a coordination between those system operators. We take into account integrate operation congestion management service at both levels. And the market design number three, there is integrated MFRR and again, operation and congestion management service at both levels. Regarding the forecasting model, this slide presents the general structure of the load forecasting model. It produces 24 hourly load values. This means that it refers to the next day, the day ahead hourly load, and receives 65 inputs that can be categorized in three different types: historical loads, external variables such as temperature and temperature indicators, and day type information. For example, a distinction codes between working days and holidays, the type of the day, etc. This model has been already, we have some results in the Greek, Bulgarian, and Romanian power systems. Here we can see the general structure of the PV forecasting model. Again, we have a day ahead forecasts depending on the time resolution. Usually it's 15 minutes. And again, we have three types of inputs: historical photovoltaic generation of various PV parks, historical temperatures and temperature forecast, and historical solar irradiation and irradiation forecasts. Lastly, this is the wind turbine generation forecasting model. Again, we have forecasts for day ahead horizon. We have again three types of inputs: historical wind turbine generation, wind speeds, wind speed forecasts, and wind direction and wind direction forecasts. This is the connection of the forecasting model with the DAM model. The forecast of the day ahead are performed within the day of operation, which is denoted as the the forecasts are held using historical loads and load generation of days that are prior to the day of operation. And there is an input selection procedure based on correlation analysis in order to select the optimal time lags that will be used as inputs in the forecasting model. Afterwards, when we reach to the day of operation, some updated information of historical loads or other variables are input are serve as inputs in the models. The model are executed again, and the updated forecasts are used in the balancing energy market model. So we're going to move to the second part of the presentation. According to the open call, according to proposal, the potential applicants involve academic institutions, research institutes, or other companies with understanding and expertise on the following fields: power system analysis and modeling, load flow studies, congestion management, active management of distribution grids, mathematical optimization, demand response, integration of variation to the distribution grids, and extensive knowledge of the Greek power system and desirable knowledge of Romanian and Bulgarian power systems. Also, the successful applicant should provide a proof of its participation in at least three organized projects that are related to electric power systems in general. Some information about the business case story. We focus on congestion management. As we all know, congestion takes place when the transmission lines reach their operational limits, so they are not sufficient to transfer the power according to the power market operation. Congestion management is a mechanism to deal with this situation. So there is a new allocation of the power in order to reach the power market request without violating the system constraints, and its scope is to prioritize the transactions in order to keep the good operation and the good quality of the transactions within the networks. So we have two different types of congestion management. The first one is cost-free congestion management. Here the infrastructure works without any economical extension. There is a nominal economical consideration. There is no involvement of generation companies and distribution companies. The slide also presents some paradigms of techniques that is used that are used in cost-free congestion management, and there is the non-cost-free congestion management that takes into account generation rescheduling and curtailment of load transactions. Regarding the Greek balancing market right now, congestion management is not traded as a service, so there is so some specific energy constraints are used in the official balancing energy management model execution. So in our demo, we propose to treat the congestion management as an additionally ancillary service, and more specifically, it will be treated as an FRR service. The overall scope is to define and quantify some generic indicators that can be utilized in various scenarios, in various networks, in both transmission system and distribution system levels. The concept involves an aggregator, which serves as an intermediate agent between the distribution system operator and a variety of distribution energy resources. The availability of DERs involve various technologies, RES technologies, storage units, and flexible loads that have been selected for specialized price-based demand response programs. This interaction between those entities include flexible offers, will include flexible offers and requests, and the flexibility of the generation units will contribute to the congestion management. The objectives of the open call is, of course, to quantify the operation congestion management requirements at both levels and the outputs of the workflow. We have three general outputs, a methodology and implementation of a methodology that involves an extensive power flow analysis. Actually, congestion management is a generalization of power flow analysis. Secondly, extensive scenario and test cases evaluation for identification of the requirements, and a final report, including the methodology part, results, and some guides and know-how utilized in the remarks, concluding remarks. This is the general workflow again. So the first part is a forecast of the day-ahead market. Then there is a formulation of the solution. The third step involves the update forecasts. The fourth step is actually our objective of the proposal. It's the congestion management methodology, and the output of this methodology will be included in the formulation of the balancing energy market model. Some information about the workflow. First of all, is a solution of power flow analysis using a variety of scenarios, taking into account various network topologies, and apply these technologies in the three test power systems. Scenarios for placement of generation and storage units within those network topologies, different scenarios of capacity of generation and storage units, scenarios for different objectives of price-based demand response, and various scenarios regarding the modeling of the consumers' response using different price versus demand functions and price elasticity formulations. Secondly, this is the core determination of the identification indexes of the capacity congestion management resources. The outputs is, as I said earlier, a generation units rescheduling and curtailment of load transactions, and those findings will be included in the models of task 7.1 of interface project. Some recommendations. Here we can see a benchmark topology. This is the European high voltage transmission network, as already proposed by SIGRE task force. This is also a well-known test system. It's relatively old. It's IEEE 180 bus system that models a transmission system. And also some recommendations about distribution networks. This is also proposed by SIGRE. This is the European Medium Voltage Distribution Network. And another network by IEEE. This is IEEE 33 bus system. Regarding the data requirements, here we have a large diversity of data that will be needed. Of course, we need the characteristics of the networks, operational and other characteristics of the distribution energy resources, economical data, of course, hourly active and reactive demand over a 24-hour period in the various buses of the systems, technical and operational data of the lines, and meteorological data for the assessment of RES capacity. We also recommend some software packages, the Power Factory Digi Silence, which is a well-known software for power flow studies, and Mat Power, which and Power System Analysis. Those are two toolboxes that are can be implemented in the MATLAB software. Some screenshots. This is a screenshot of the Power Factory Digi Silence. This is a screenshot of the MatPower. As I said earlier, this is implemented in the MATLAB software package. And Power System Analysis Toolbox involves a user-friendly interface. Some recommendations about the technical data. This is actually a very good repository where someone can find information about the network benchmark topologies. Regarding meteorological data, there are two well-known databases where the user can enter the location of a specific RES unit and download some information data regarding wind speed, solar radiation indexes, and temperature. Thank you very much. For further clarification, please feel free to contact myself or my colleague, Dr. Nikolaos Koltsakis from University of Piraeus. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ioannis. So again, if there are questions related to this business use case, but of course, any general question about the open calls and the other business use cases as well. I see already one question in the Q&A.
So can I answer the question?
Yes,
sorry.
Yes.
Yes, we are actually we are referring to scenarios. Yes, we take into account a variety of scenarios, as we described earlier, both in TSO and DSO level. I don't know if this answer the question, or please provide if can provide further comments about my answer.
Konstantinos, could I add also a comment?
Yes, Nicholas, please.
Yes, the point is to identify some generic indicators through extensive scenario examination on various topologies on both TSO and DSO. Levels in order to apply them to different actual power systems, such as the Greek, the Romanian, and the Bulgarian power system. So the point is to define a generic methodology which could be applied and modified in a range of different power systems.
Probably, I don't know, I'm just brainstorming. Probably the question refers to if it is also a simulated scenario. So if this business case is related to a simulated framework, let's say.
Yes, that will be conducted extensive simulations in one or some of the above referenced toolboxes. And the final, let's say, deliverable is to define a generic methodology based on these extensive simulations in order to identify and quantify the requirements, the congestion management requirements on various power systems at the national level.
Okay, very good. More questions related to all use cases or business cases? Okay. In any case, all the presentations will be made available online, so you can have a look again on the presentations, and they will be available in the you will be feel free to contact us for any questions to the portal. Maria, you want to repeat any to make a recap about the process?
First of all, thank you all for the attendance and presenters for the support. The help desk is working, so if any question arises, they can send it there, and we will contact the experts to give their answers. This is my comment.
Okay. Do you wish to repeat again the deadlines about the registration?
The summit happens the 30th on Tuesday, and when we have the second webinar too. And the deadline is the 30th of June by 5 o'clock set time. I think this is for now the date that they should have in mind. And the implementation of the selected proposals will start in December of 2021. This is to how to schedule that.
Okay, so there are no any other questions. So probably we can conclude the webinar. From my side, I would like to thank all the presenters, as well as all the attendees for their expressed interest on the business proposals. So thank you all very much for attending this webinar. And again, we'd like to remind you that on the 30th, of March, we have the second webinar related to the rest business proposals, three more business proposals for the open calls of interface project. So we're concluding the meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Goodbye, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.